All right, Ed, we should be good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Northwest Theater Workshop's Zippy Zoom Shortz with Comedy Sports. My name is Wayne Harrell, and I am your host for this fabulous evening. Tonight is a collaboration between Northwest Theater Workshop and Comedy Sports Portland. Northwest Theater Workshop's mission is to empower theater as an active and timely cultural force through the creation, development, and production of new work by Northwest artists. ComedySportz is Portland's improv comedy champion, providing laughs for everyone. We've joined up together, these two companies, to present four brand new plays for your enjoyment tonight. We'll tell you more about those plays in just a moment, but first, I want to share a few tips for you to help you maximize your viewing pleasure. First of all, if you're new to Zoom or Zoom theater, we want to encourage you to hide the non-video participants. Those are every once in a while, something will pop up and it'll have somebody's name on it instead of seeing their face. So that means they're a non-video participant. We want you to hide them. So to do that, you can either slide up to the right-hand corner of your screen right up here, or perhaps it might be right down here in the bottom left. But up on the right-hand corner, there's three little dots. Give it a click and see if you can hide non-video participants there. If it doesn't show up there, try it down below on the left where there's the camera. There's a little carrot right there. Click on that and then search for hide non-video participants and click that. Then they'll go away and you'll see just what you're supposed to see. But to help you also do that, we want you to see us in gallery view. So again, back up in the upper right-hand corner, there's another little option there of speaker view or gallery view. You want gallery view. Okay. Now, also, we want to hear you. We'd love to, you know, we miss being live in a room together, and we can still kind of get some of that effect if you actually open your mic. So we want to invite you to unmute your mic. Go ahead and open it up so we can hear your laughs and your cheers for our players tonight. To do that, again, go back down to the bottom left-hand corner and next to the microphone, there's another carrot. Click on that, open your audio settings, and then you want to reduce your input level to about 20%. It's a little slider bar, just slide it to the left to about 20%. Also, unmute your microphone so that we can hear you. And then we'll be good to go. And you can laugh and cheer and cry, okay? Just remember that your mic is on. So, you know, if the dog comes in barking or other business happens, be careful about that. Let's see, what else we got? Oh yeah, chat. We're gonna leave chat open all the way through our four shows today. And we'd love for you to just give us comments. I see people already are chipping in and saying things on the comments. We're gonna leave that open all the time so that you can say things to the actors, you can respond to the shows, reply, say hey to your friend who's watching in Arizona or Connecticut or Gladstone, wherever they're at. All right, so go ahead and leave those on. Leave that open. Also, make sure though that you send your comments to attendees and panelists. Oh, sorry, it's panelists and attendees. Okay, panelists, that's just us backstage people, but the attendees are all of you. So send your comments to all of them. Let's see, what else? Okay, now let's talk about our four plays. I'm gonna tell you a little bit about how they came to be and then we'll go right into it. All right. So last week during this time, last week, Friday night, we got together with ComedySportz and ComedySportz host Patrick Short led us through a bunch of fun sketches and improv scenes. And then we also explored some elements that are going to come into play tonight. This is a process that Northwest Theater Workshop has developed and we call them Mad Libs, Mad Lib prompts. And for that, we're looking for a person, a place, a prop, and some kind of thematic struggle. So for example, we would put out all these options and people like for person, it would be something like a lumberjack or a lion tamer or a yoga instructor. For a prop, it could be an axe or a skull or a feather duster. For a place, it would be someplace online, like a Zoom date or an exercise session. And then finally, a thematic struggle that people were struggling with, like being torn between justice and abuse of power, or between an urge to nurture or an urge to control. So we set up all of those options last week, and then Patrick used a poll to choose. So we started with playwright number one, and then from that, our audience chose a person, a prop, a place, and an event, and a thematic struggle for that writer. And then that writer took that, and it came into a phrase, something like, once upon a time, there was a person with a prop, at an online event who was torn between this and that. So for example, one of our playwrights, Justine Hamlin, was given the task. Once upon a time, there was a vampire with a box of cereal on an online date who is torn between chaos and order. That prompt was given to Justine, and then she had 48 hours to write a complete play that explored all of those things. That happened four times. So we had four playwrights working with similar prompts. Those plays were done by last Sunday night, and then the scripts went to our stellar cast and crew, and they've been working nonstop this week to rehearse and present those to you. And that's where we're at right now. And so, without further ado, I want to welcome you and introduce you to the world premiere of Northwest Theater Workshop's Zippy Zoom Shortz with Comedy Sports.
Tamer Trent speaking. Yes, sir. I've been expecting your call. Oh, about the incident. The decision is final? With all due respect, Remaster, is there another way? Do we really have to put him down? I know I shouldn't question your authority, but it's just that I've known him for so long and that... Yes, sir. I understand. If it must be done, I should be one to tell him. I'll tell him about it. It's my responsibility. Yes, sir. I'm his boss. I insist. Yes, sir. I'll let Sam know right away. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Why are we online? I thought we were training together in the tent today.
No.
I've been practicing that twirl trick for our new act. Okay, snap your fingers. Ta-da!
Well done, Sam.
I learned from the best.
So I'm afraid I got some bad news, kid.
It's about what I did last night, huh?
Set the pillow down.
It relaxes me.
I know it relaxes you, but it also distracts you. And right now, I need you to focus.
Remember when you gave it to me? When we first met?
Yes, years ago. You were just a cub.
I was like, oh, dude, it's pink like steak, but fluffy like fur.
Stop trying to change the subject. This isn't easy for me. In fact, it's one of the hardest things I've ever had to do in my life.
Oh, I'm grounded, huh?
Grounded? No, kid. I love you, but I gotta help you understand. This is way more serious than that. What you did last night was a big deal, and it has big consequences.
I know it was stupid.
It was dangerous. I don't know what got into you. You broke out of your cage on purpose.
I picked the lock with my claw.
You walked down the concourse, past the big top, and right up to the front curb.
I was feeling frisky.
You hopped into the first open car you saw. You put your paws on the steering wheel. And
it was just like our clown car in our act, only bigger.
What were you thinking? You wanted to go for a joyride?
Don't even have my learner's permit.
That's not the point, Sam. You're a lion. Your fangs scared the driver away. But before you even crashed into the tilt-a-whirl, three other drivers smashed into each other. One of them is threatening to sue. That can take down the entire circus.
Feel terrible, so guilty. All last night, I just kept hoping it was a bad dream.
Me too. Listen, this the ringmaster's made it official. This is so hard for me to say. Because of your dangerous, careless choices, the circus has decided to have you removed.
moved. I don't understand. You're firing me?
No, what? Yes! I'm firing you. That's it. The circus says you need to go away.
I've always had a place here. I've jumped through all the hoops, even the flaming ones. That's why you give me my steaks and my pillow and stuff. You trained me to jump.
I know it hurts, but these are the rules. So just pack up your pillow and go.
I just don't understand. It doesn't add up. I know I'm not free to go outside my pen, but I always thought I had the freedom to make mistakes. If you hopped in a car, would the circus fire you?
Look, it's not all your fault. Like, I make mistakes too. I checked the lock, but I never thought you would break out, or even want to. So I'm also responsible.
How can you be responsible if I'm responsible?
You're responsible for your actions, but you're still learning. And until you grow up, I have to teach you. I'm your trainer. So that's what I'm trying to do now, teach you.
I think you're not telling me everything.
I'm choosing my words carefully. There's more to it. Do you have to know everything?
I know my prowl last night was bad. I get that. But was it so bad that I don't deserve to know the whole story?
You do deserve to know the whole story. It's just hard for me to tell it. It's not your fault. Like I said, the circus has decided not to have any animals at all. There's organizations for the ethical treatment of animals, and they're protesting. They're mad. They think we shouldn't have any animals at all. They think you should go live in the wild.
The wild is, like, totally harsh. It's scary. I'm safe here. You feed me and give me treats, and I get dental checkups.
In some places, their concerns are justified. Most places, perhaps. But many tamers aren't as careful as taking care of you as I am.
Well, what is the circus going to do about all the people who like to see animals?
They're going to replace you with machines. Machines that move. Robots.
Animal robots?
Yes, they're called animatronics.
Dude, for real?
Yeah, they're getting more realistic these days. There's a huge initiative. And they don't need food or drink or dental checkups.
How come I haven't heard any of the other animals talking about this?
You're the first one to know, and we haven't told any other animals, so just keep it under your mane for now.
When are these animatronics gonna get here?
It's only a matter of time.
So they're firing you too, huh?
Why would you say that?
Well, if they're getting rid of us, they won't need you anymore.
You're accusing me of being useless?
I'm accusing you of being a liar.
How dare you?
It's the way you hold your hand. You hold your hand like this. I've seen it before. You do it when we're in the ring, when you're telling one of your tall tales. The audience may not see it, but I do. I've known you a long time. Besides, that robot story is like totally far-fetched.
You're right, kid. I was just trying to make up a story to make you feel better. You understand why I want you to feel better, right?
Kinda.
I just didn't want to make you feel any worse. But from now on, I promise to be honest with you, even if it's hard. I guess that's why they call it brutal honesty.
Why?
Because I assume the truth will hurt you.
Just tell me! Rawr! What are you holding back?
The punishment for the incident, the orders from the ringmaster, when I said the circus wants to have you fired, it's not to have you fired, it's to have you killed.
I am just really pissed off that you didn't think I could handle the truth. I may not be an adult yet, but I almost am, and I'm not a baby anymore.
I know. I realize that. You're taking it very well. The circus doing what they're doing to you after you've given so much to the circus, and you're way more mature than I assumed, and I'm sorry about that. Listen.
It's I don't just know if that, I want to listen to you anymore.
A good thing came out of my blunder, out of my lies. You gave me the idea to change what we do. When I couldn't bring myself to say the circus want to have you killed, I came to see that maybe we can have you fired instead.
Either way, what's it matter? I'm not wanted.
Don't you see? I want you to live. I want you to survive. I want to fire you. I'm desperate to fire you so you can survive.
Huh?
Look, if we can get you out of the circus and out of the country, the circus will see that you're gone. The ringmaster will think I got rid of you, and you'll be gone just like they assumed that you'll be out of here.
It's not like telling the complete story.
Look at me, Sam. Remember this gesture from our earlier days of training?
Trust.
That's right. Trust. I'm turning my back on a ferocious lion. I'm saying that I'm vulnerable, defenseless. You can pounce on me.
I can jump through flaming hoops, but I can't jump through the computer.
That's not what I'm trying to impart here. I'm telling you that I trust you, and I promise I'll be honest with you from now on. So I hope that you can trust me. What the ringmaster though? Just this once, maybe it can be like a tall tale.
But if I leave, where will I go?
The wild.
No, I can't. It's too scary. I'll be all alone. What good will my circus tricks do me out there? With no one to feed me steaks, I'll have to hunt. And no one to comb my fur? I won't survive. I'll probably have to drink out of some muddy pond and I'll maybe
Your fur looks amazing. It's charming today.
Thanks.
I've been holding you back, Sam. Yes, the wild will challenge you. I won't deny that. It won't be one of the hardest things that you've ever done, to be brutally honest.
Yeah.
But you have space to roam. You have new adventures, and you'll be in a new environment. And if you can figure out how to pick a lock, you can figure out how to catch a meal.
Maybe.
I've been overprotective of you. I've been reluctant to let you go anywhere. I don't want to lose you, but I've got to let you go.
I'm scared.
For a long time, you've been a part of the circus. You've been a part of my life, too. The best part, actually. But you're growing up. You're becoming your own lion.
I guess I won't need this in the wild. Maybe I'll leave it here for you, like a memento.
Yeah, I'll treasure it. I promise. I'll take good care of it. And I'll help you get out to the wild, and I'll come visit you, and I'll give you dental checkups, and I'll just make sure you're okay. You can do this, Sam. You can do this. Do you trust me?
I learn from the best. So, are you coming over now to get me out of my den?
Yes.
Okay, just one more thing.
You name it, kid.
On the way to the wild, maybe you should drive.
Here comes the hot stepper. Hi.
Oh, ooh. Hi. Hi. My name is Frank.
Hi, I'm Heather, and I'm really happy to be here.
This is my 39th date on Lonely Vamps. How many dates have you been on?
Well, let's see. There was the guy that we kept talking all the time.
What's your favorite color? Mine is red, obviously.
That's a good one. I see you brought cereal to our date.
Oh, yes. It's my lucky charm.
Oh. That's Count Chocula, right? Didn't they stop making that like 20 years ago?
Well, it reminds me of my this particular cereal was made in 1987.
Right, right. Oh, I know this. And they had to pull it quickly from the shelves because of that big controversy
surrounding the necklace.
Right.
How did you know?
Yeah, well, we've met before.
Yes. It must have been fantastic. Yes.
You don't remember me, do you?
Well, it's not unusual for us to forget. I guess you didn't leave much of a mark.
Ah. Oh.
Get it? Much of a mark?
Oh, right, right. Fangs for the memories. Gotcha. But, you know, Frank, we did meet before. I'm Heather, VW Bus. We're about the same age. Anything?
And, of course, you don't forget things.
Oh, no memory problems here. I am footloose and fancy free.
Your thing.
Yeah, well, hey, I can prove that I know you, that we met before, because, well, okay, so have you been to Death Valley lately? Because that's your favorite vacation spot.
Doesn't prove a thing.
Favorite beer.
Budweiser. Okay, you're fine. We have met before, but you are not normal. Color me pink. You're not lying. How did you keep your memories intact?
Well, it's certainly not by following that rigid schedule routine like you do.
Come on. Tell me, really. I've been living in the same coffin since 1973, for Pete's sake. This should be working.
Well, like I told you before, I don't have a permanent place for my coffin. I just get in my converted VW bus and I start... Let me tell it to you this way. Have you ever heard of something called jamais vu? Okay, so what it is, it's that eerie sense that you get. It's kind of crazy, and it's because that you are seeing something for the first time, but you actually know that you've seen it before.
I'm 183 years old. Of course I have seen things before.
Right, right. Of course, of course. So like, for example, Death Valley. Your favorite place, right? So is it still the same as it was 50 years ago?
Yes, it's the same.
Really? Like no erosion, all the signs?
I guess they did rebuild the visitor center in 2012.
Right,
and...
see, a place changes over time and it can start feeling unfamiliar even though you know it really well.
I guess.
How about this? Tell me about your coffin. I bet it's hideous.
I like lime green, okay?
I know, I remember.
And paisley will never go out of fashion.
That color never coming back. How about this? Do you ever have problems finding your coffin before dawn?
Maybe. And then it's a grave situation.
And your favorite food is a sugar-laden processed cereal that's just never going to perish, right?
I started eating this in 1970 because it looks like my friend Jimmy. Oh, have you ever heard Count Chocula Goes to Hollywood? Yes.
No, no. Doesn't it seem like you're a little stagnated, Frank?
Oh, Frank? I wasn't listening. I was only thinking about monsters, like Frankenberry. Get it? Monsters?
Right. Focus, Frank. Focus.
Okay.
Okay, so as I was saying, don't you think you're a little too into your routine? I mean, when was the last time you did something random?
Puns are random. They are, right? Oh, for Pete's sake. You're right. No, I'm not random. I got to be more random. I'm going to start eating granola. I'm going to change my coffin to a bamboo lining. I'm going to throw out this stupid thing. I'm going to go somewhere random.
Yes. Yes. Actually, yes. That's great.
Where do vampires go on vacation?
Vegas?
Malibu! Yes, yes, yes.
Right.
Okay. For the sake of randomness, you pick. I'm going to surrender to chaos, to the pandemonium, down with randomness, up without routine. Yes.
Down with routine, right? Okay.
Yes, yes.
Let's
yes.
pull up a few Google Maps and see what what's panda?
Oh, it's when a group of pandas cause chaos, of course. Get it? Pandas. Come on. Yes. That's funny. Yes. Okay, okay, okay. Okay, okay. So here we go. Yes. Man.
Okay, these puns are just going to keep being a thing, right?
Yes. Well, you know. All right. I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. Somewhere close?
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. What? Why don't you put your address in the chat?
Okay.
Yes, Boise? Boise's random.
Boise, okay, but potato puns are dumb. You do have Wi-Fi in your van, right? I mean... Yeah. It is important.
Oh, yeah, it is. It is. It's a little spotty, but it's okay. I know. How about that replica Stonehenge thing?
Okay, sure. But your van keeps out UVA and UVB rays, right? I mean, it is important.
Yeah, I don't really know. I mean, I just kind of throw some old paint on the back windows and it's a beautiful view.
Yes. I think I'm going to check the weather first. Plan it out a bit. I wouldn't want to get enlightened.
What happened? Down routine. Are you having some thoughts?
No, you're right. Jimmy would have liked it. Yes.
I don't know about that. He thought it was a gimmick.
What? You knew Jimmy?
No biggie. We traveled together for a minute.
Ah, yes. Jimmy was a good phlebotomist.
Right.
No, really. I mean, one day he was so forgetful, and then the next, he walks out into the sun. Wait a minute. You knew Jimmy.
Ooh.
Yeah.
You travel with Jimmy.
Yeah.
For Pete's sake. You really are a pain in the neck.
Ooh.
You got Jimmy to abandon his schedule.
Well, yeah. But to be fair, there was kind of more to it than that. He really wanted to.
Calling me pink. You killed Jimmy. You got Jimmy to change his schedule. Walk right into the sunlight. Oh.
Jimmy took chaos too far.
Oh, this is a horrible idea. I can't just give up my coffin. I love lime green.
But wait, I just want to help.
You, ma'am, have helped quite enough.
Frank, I might have gone too far with Jimmy.
Might have.
But it's the whole reason I signed up for this stupid dating app was to talk to you because, well, you didn't listen last time and I want to talk with you about this.
You just want to drive a stake right into my heart. Give me the old sunlight bath, huh?
No. I can help you.
By getting me to blindly move my routine, by killing me, huh?
No. I mean,
I knew it. I'm doomed, cursed to walk the face of this earth as a forgetful living thing.
No. You're not doomed.
Doomed, I tell you. I'll die under the sunlight.
No, quit it.
No. Give up my routines.
I didn't mean blindly, but if you give up just some routine for some new memories, it might help.
It didn't help for Jimmy. And what pray tell do you suggest that I abandon?
Well, that stupid expired cereal for one.
I beg your pardon. This cereal box has been available since 1987.
That's what I mean. If you want to stay fresh, you can't rely on an ancient, dumb box of cereal to do it. You're getting these old, expired memories dragging you down. And in the end...
But you still have your memories.
Well, not all. Some. Enough. And, you know, there's more to have. It's good. Like I've been saying, I keep my coffin the same. Mm. And my surroundings keep changing.
Okay. What color is your coffin then?
Oh, well, I agree with you about paisley. But my real favorite color is burnt orange. I mean, that print, it is mesmerizing.
I knew it! So you think changing my cereal will really help me?
What have you got to lose?
Besides my life? Okay, I guess you're right. I mean, I always thought the Lucky Charms fellow looked a little bit like Dan Bonaducci. So who better to recommend such a wholesome cereal?
Down with routine.
Yes. Hit the road, Jack. Come and get me.
Okay, I'm on my way. Oh, but first, you never know where your food is.
Okay, Heather, I'll bite. Tell me, what's your favorite food?
Nectarines, of course.
Oh, I think you do better than that. Yes.
Hmm. Yay!
Woo!
Oh, there, look at that. There you are. Hey, sweetheart. It's so good to see your face.
Yours too. I didn't start the meeting too soon, did I? I mean, I don't want to rush you. I didn't rush you.
No, goodness, no. No, you started it right on time.
Good. Yeah. Oh, I'm so excited about this date, you know, to kind of check in with you.
Yeah, this is a great idea. It's so handy to just know that I'm going to see you like 5 times this week.
Yes. The country between us feels smaller already.
You're so smart with this and so strong, my love. Oh, I see you got the package I sent you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, wait. Oh, wait. No, Zoom's being weird again. No, I can't hear you. Can you hear me? No. Ah, I think Zoom's prioritizing wrong again. Can you do the thing? Do the thing. Babe? Oh, there you are.
Can you
there
hear you me now? Yeah. Oh, there yeah. you, there you are.
Well, cheers.
Cheers. I am so looking forward to when we can have dinner together every night in the same place. No Zoom dance. And maybe breakfast, too. I know. Soon.
Yeah. After the season. Yeah. And focus. Your gift. Open it before things get all weird again. Go. Okay. Wait. There's a story. First, you should know that I made that by hand. And it's for the dust so you don't sneeze so much. I love how I can just see you thinking as I speak.
You made this by hand. It's lovely.
Yeah, we were felling off that north ridge and some limbs shook down. And when they landed, I found a lot of feathers. A nest must have gotten taken out.
You think an owl?
Was crushed? Yes. Yeah, that nest was just destroyed.
Mac!
What?
You sent me the carcass of a dead owl and you think that's okay?
What? Yeah, I saw the feathers and I thought they were too good not to use, and I thought how they'd make a great duster. And I thought of you and I wanted to take care of you.
Oh, that's very sweet. What? How could you not see that this is a horrific, horrendous idea? A terrible idea. How could you not see that?
Oh, it's a federal crime. Oh, jeez.
Yes, a federal crime.
I didn't even think.
I know. You just focused on the resources it produced. This is like how you want us to choose where we're going to move based on average apartment cost and access to bargain grocery stores. You are so stuck on the concrete aspects of it that you forget to look and realize that something might actually be a horrible idea or a terrible fit.
Would you rather the owl died and I let the feathers go to waste? You had the same freak out when offers were going to take us across the country. You wanted me to stay or you to come with me and try to find work out here in Oregon. That would have been so wasteful of our time and our funds. You have to see, just like when we decided to take these jobs, that this was the right thing to do, considering what's available to us right now.
I love that we buckled down and decided to take jobs on opposite coasts of the country in order to build a nest egg for our future and the next step. But this separation, only seeing you, is so hard. I know. It was in order to expedite the next step to our living together and to our wedding.
And kids.
Yes, and kids. I want that because I love you, because you are so thoughtful as to make a feather duster by hand to help reduce my allergies, and so dedicated as to move 2,800 miles away and work so hard for our future family. But I hate this job. I hate that we put nature to use rather than foster its growth.
I know, love, I know. It's not great, but it's the best use of opportunities available to us right now.
Well, speaking of opportunities available to us right now, so how have your applications been going? Did you reach out to that program director of Parks and Rec?
Since the last time we talked?
This is what you said you wanted. You said that with you out there all by yourself, you would have so much time that there'd be plenty of opportunity for you to reach out and then figure out how to leap off to get to that next stage where you can be a park director or a park ranger.
I don't know who to reach out to, and I don't want to just email a program director without more information, like some schlub who doesn't know who I'm talking to. So they'll think I'm some idiot and tell me no out of hand.
So you're just going to not ask for help, just give up on it, rather than push through the possible rejection right now in order to get to that future with me and our family. You are buried in this functional, technically doing the right thing, gathering a savings, checking boxes, but you're not really actually joining in on this future of you and me together, where you're doing the job that you love and we're making a family together. I can't be here alone on this. You have to join in with me. We have to do this together to make it happen.
I think working as hard as we are and putting money away as much as we are is the best thing that we can do right now to be future parents.
Babe, future parents, like that owl was gonna be.
What? What are we talking about? I'm checking boxes? Owl parents?
You killed an owl. Probably a whole family, given that it's early March and there were probably eggs in that nest. You don't get to tell me that you have the right parental priorities when you don't even have the emotional awareness to see the impact you had on that life. That owl was killed. Its family destroyed. And you are the one that shook that branch. And you don't see that as horrific?
Okay, yes, I see that as horrific. It's awful. Have I checked the right box now?
No, because that's not how it works, checking boxes for our future. You have to join in. You have to be open to this, open to failure, open to loss, open to help, open to the potential of an unknown future, which takes heavy lifting, which, I mean, you don't have to do if you just want out.
No. I want to do that. I want in on that future with you. I want you and us and the life we talked about. This is just impossible to explain.
Mac, you can tell me anything. I mean, You told me you sent me a dead owl carcass as a gift. You can say literally anything.
I could do it. I could work to become a park ranger and then end up stuck in some office and then find out this thing that I worked so hard to become and maybe even move you across the country to pursue is the worst and that I hate it. And then we'll have this future where I'm just miserable and maybe you too. I mean, of course you too. I can't believe how it just lumped you in. Like, you wouldn't be directly affected. I'm sorry. I think of myself as just completely isolated or independent. So how could my being unhappy affect you? Like that owl, just alone and done. But I didn't even think of the impact of the loss of that owl on other owls. Like, it's March. That owl had babies. Owl had other baby owls, and it didn't even occur to me. I just saw feathers, and I thought of how I could do something that you like. How did I do that? I sent you the remnants of something that was alive until I got involved. I didn't consider my impact. I don't consider my impact. I can't even look at the Park Ranger website without having a panic attack. I'm having a panic attack. I can't. Sam, I can't have a kid.
Well, I mean, no, not without me.
Well, no, not without you. I only want kids with you. But also, the person who I sent a dead owl didn't even flinch in that maybe this was a terrible idea. I can't have a kid.
Not now.
Sam.
Mac.
I love you.
I love you.
I don't know what to do.
It's okay.
I feel like I should do something.
Do you want to break up?
No. No. I want you in my life.
Okay.
But maybe I shouldn't worry about what I want. I want to do what's right for you.
Can I think on it?
Of course.
I think I'm gonna sign off now.
Okay, yeah. That makes sense. I'll be here for you when you come back.
Everyone, and karma be with you. I'm Shoshana Savasana. Welcome to my new, never-before-seen yoga flow here at Karma Studio. I see a lot of familiar faces, and I see a ton of new ones as well. Hi, hello, yes, It's good to see you. Yes, I see you holding your Ecofiber Organic Mineral Healing Hoop. I'll talk more about that later. But first, I want to congratulate you for making this high investment in yourself and continuing your yoga journey with me. Oh, thank you. I want to acknowledge that I am the best, and I see you. Now, a lot of you reported feeling pain and body aches after our last session with me, and I want to say that pain is part of the process, but suffering is optional. I do have a few slots left for my one-on-one private coaching care. Normally, the investment is $49.97, but because you have already purchased the class, I will accept two installments of $24.98.50. Now, let's talk about the eco-friendly chakra healing, transcending healing hoop you have in your hands as part of your purchase with this registration.
All right. Shoshana is a liar!
Oh, I beg
your pardon. Shoshana is a liar!
Jessica, oh, I beg your pardon.
Shoshana's lying and stealing from you. Her teachings are misleading and false. She spits on the grave of true yogis and yoginis who've brought nothing but peace, happiness, health, and well-being to this world. It's time to come clean, Shoshana. You are no master.
I'm not sure who this is either, class, and I don't know where you're getting this information, but I'm afraid you're wrong. As you can see from my studio and on my website, as well as Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok, I am certified under Master Yoganada, and this was given to me by Master Yoganada after I defeated him in the Iron Yoga, the most excruciating yoga challenge in the highest regard. That's right, everyone. Iron Yoga is where each contender picks three divine poses as it inflicts harm on the body, mind, and soul in order to reach the highest form of mastery. Stories say there has only been one other being who's done what I've done. Oh, now class, don't pick on Jessica. We don't want to be bullies. We get enough of that from the world already. As you can see, Jessica, this is a safe space, and these subscribers all support me because I'm their healer. I have an idea. Why don't we have Jessica be my assistant for today's intense practice?
And what if I refuse?
Oh, come on now. Yeah. This is a sit-in, or what yogis refer to as a sukshasana. Either you participate fully, or I will boot you out. And just so the class is aware of this, Karma Studios does not offer refunds or makeup classes.
Fine, I'll do it. But only because I care for these students more. And I don't want you to hurt anyone else.
Good. Today's class is about the Wheel of Life, and we will be using our slim fit, environmentally supportive, chakra cleansing, sweat blocking healing hoops. In just a moment, But first, let's start with a karmic flow. Now, I'm the only one who's completed this, so it's okay if you need time, Jessica. First.
The karmic flow, first invented by Master Yogananda in 1972. That's easy. Just keep your tailbone under your core, square your shoulders with the mat, and relax your jaw.
Well, I don't know how you knew that. Good job, Jessica. This may have been inspired by Master Yogananda's work in the past, but I have added on to it by introducing the power of the healing hoop. See, class, the healing hoop can be used to support you through tougher moves like so. And it's also part of the teachings of yoga in the Wheel of Life. Karma simply means what goes around comes around. And if...
Shoshana, did you learn anything from your master? Karma is more than a cliche phrase. It's about the laws of cause and effect. When Master Yogananda merged his teachings with the Tibetan monks...
Enough! Well, I'm sick of hearing about Master Yogananda. I'm putting an end to this, just like I put an end to him.
You killed my master.
Your master? What do you mean, your master? Who are you? Gasp! It's you. He's always talked about you. You're
the prodigy.
You were his favorite.
And now I must avenge my master's death. You will pay for this crime.
Master Yogananda wasn't practicing anymore anyway. I did him a favor. Besides, I invented the healing hoop. I gave thousands of people the opportunity to learn what has never been taught before.
This is too advanced and dangerous for them. Without the proper training, you could paralyze someone.
Of course these moves are painful, but I care about my students. The only thing Master Yogananda cared about was you. He wasn't the same after you. I'm a better yoga master than he ever was, and I'm certainly a better yogini than you.
Prove it!
The orbiting moon into the falling star. You can't do that, can you?
Ow!
Not even close. I don't know why I ever thought you were my competition. Looks like you need to go back to basics, Jessica.
What is in this, Shoshana? Made from radioactive materials in Chernobyl?
That's funny. It looks to me like you have a defective healing hoop. The same one I gave Master Yogananda as a peace offering right before I took this.
You intentionally killed my master with this garbage.
And what are you going to do about it?
That's it! I challenge you to iron yoga!
And why would I ever accept that challenge? You couldn't even pull off my simple vinyasa.
If you win, I will silence myself and never practice yoga again. And I will declare you the best teacher, better in all the world, even over Master Yogananda. But if I win, you have to give the people back their money and apologize for what you've done. And close your studio forever. Is that fair?
Three poses.
Three poses.
And you go away forever.
Justice will be served.
You're on.
My turn. Master Yoganada taught me about what's right. The karmic flow of what's positive and negative. About what's healing and defending. There are all these things that happen that need to be done. There is truth and justice, positive, negative, and it's about the quality of those actions, the intention and the discipline. And my master taught me one more thing. And that is...
dovetail twist!
Give up, Shoshana!
Never!
Oh, and Shoshana, karma be with you. Listen up, everyone. Those healing hoops, they're toxic. They contaminate your body. You must get rid of them now.
No, don't listen to her. Somebody call an ambulance. Somebody please help me.
This is Karma Studio signing off forever. Hashtag Karma be with you.
Hurrah! Hurrah, hurrah, hurrah! Congratulations, everyone! Let's go! Give everybody a round of applause! Let's bring back all our actors, Mr. Michael Buchanan, Angela Mictum, take a bow! Carlson, Katie Timberley, James Montgomery, are just about to join us and tell us about their experiences. So now, as our actors are signing off one last time, I want to thank you, the audience, once again for joining us. We have two more performances yet of this show to come tomorrow at 2:00 Pacific time, and then also Sunday at 4 p.m. So tell your friends about this great free show. And a reminder that since this is a great free show, this is a great time, if you like what you saw, to throw us a little love. You can give a donation to either theater company. We're doing this all on spec ourselves today. And whatever you give and share with us will be divided among the wonderful people that you've seen at work tonight. So that's portlandcomedy.com or nwtw.org. There are donation buttons on either site. It's also been listed there in the chat for you to easily click on. Okay. In the meantime, too, we invite you to consider our next shows besides the ones coming up this Saturday and Sunday, the individual work done by ComedySportz. They are busy guys. They work all the time, and they've got shows starting tomorrow night at 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock, and the next day, and the next day. Just check out their schedule at portlandcomedy.com, and you can read all about it. Or at Northwest Theater Workshop, we have a showcase of new works coming up in May, on May 15th. And if you go to our events page at Northwest Theater Workshop, you'll be able to learn about our showcase of coming up of all new works that are being developed by our writers, not ones that were just dashed out overnight. But it's good for us, and it makes us better writers. And in fact, now I would like to welcome our writers. Please, writers, check in, turn on your videos. Please welcome Brad Bolchunas, Justine Hanlon. Wow, this is nice, nicely done, right on cue. Kate Belden. And Jonathan Hernandez.
And
all right, everybody, give another round of applause to our playwrights, these four intrepid souls who one week ago tonight, right now, were given an assignment, and boom, in 2 days, they had to deliver the scripts that you saw. So I just wanted to ask right off the top, all you playwrights, was it everything you imagined? Kate, what do you say?
Can you hear me all right? Just making sure.
You're quiet.
Okay, I can fix that. It was a really fun process for me. We have quite the system that does a lot of checks and balances, so it was great to know that my intention was getting out there, even in such a short process, because I had so many check-ins and just structure check-ins, not even like dialogue or anything. And then, oh my gosh, the ComedySportz people are amazing. They're just amazing.
Kate was also, I forgot to mention, well, you know, you might have noticed in the program, Kate was the assistant stage manager, and she had her settings at a different level. So Kate, I'm sorry I chose you first tonight.
Did that work out? Can you hear me now?
Yep. Okay, you boosted it up. Thanks. Brad Bolchunas, what was your first thoughts in there, what you just saw? And remind us of the show you wrote.
I wrote, Whose Lion Is It Anyway? Yeah, I'm so thrilled by the ComedySportz folks and Eric, director, and the whole cast and crew. And there was support from fellow playwrights here all the way through the process, which helped some frantic late night text messages about just how, you know, what have we gotten into, that sort of thing. So yeah, it's all in all, exciting, and I'm honored.
Great. Jonathan Hernandez was our yoga master. How was it? Nice and mellow? Was it just kind of like a calm, soothing experience for you,
so
John?
Calm. It was so serene. No, as soon as I got the prompt, I was like, okay, how am I going to do this? But, I really enjoyed it, and working with the actors and, Nick. And then also, I also had a buddy, who lives in Houston. I don't know if he's still on, but Jeff B was helping me kind of get all my ideas, and we would brainstorm and stuff like that. So the process was really, even though it was excruciating, a lot less sleep, a lot of coffee, and like small amounts of sleep. It was really fun. It felt actually, because I'm into theater so much, it really felt to me like a tech run where you do 12 hours a day, you know, working on a show, we're collaborating with people. And then we had, I had this idea of all the playwrights being in a chat together through text, and that they were just so inspiring and motivating, and I loved venting to them and stuff like that. So it was really fun. Oh, it was the closest thing that I felt to live theater than the actual live experience. So.
Yeah, we're trying. Speaking of live theater, Justine Hanlon is a relative newbie here. What is this, Justine? Is this your second play or the third play you've ever written in all your days?
Second
alone, but you're a major part of the Thirst Project, and don't try to dodge that.
Quiet, you.
Ha ha.
So I know Justine is a hardworking professional who's accustomed to late nights, but late night as a playwright, what was that like for you? Cranking this out in 2 days. Are you frozen?
It was different thing. I hope, no, that's just the terror. That was the terror on my face. Yeah.
Sorry, I was a trigger. I triggered you there, didn't I? She's doing it again.
Here, I'm just gonna stay like this, okay? Ass. No, it was great. Like Jonathan, a team chat. CG was there to be very helpful, of course. Michelle calmed me down. I also phoned a friend. My friend Marin was very helpful in talking me off the ledge of trying to make Marin cereal into something that was, I guess. So yeah, it was good.
Looks like good. Sounds like you used all your options and you came out a millionaire. Let's see. Let's go with. So now I want to just kind of retouch quickly what your assignments were and what that was like. So just to remind folks, CG Guerin, who they just mentioned, she's the producing artistic director of Northwest Theater Workshop. Amazing. And this whole thing is her brainstorm to put playwrights through the troubles. Yes. And so Brad Bolchunas, can you remind us what was the...
I'm going to have to try to figure out how to get it on my phone.
Oh, gosh.
The prompt?
Wayne, you need to unmute yourself, love. I'm sorry.
Yep. No, I just saw that. It looks like somebody was tired. Backstage was tired of me talking. So Brad,
no.
what was your prompt?
The audience selected a lion tamer with a pink fluffy pillow, who was at the firing of someone on Zoom. And torn between communication and assumption.
Great. So out of those, which one of those made you go, oh yeah, I know just what to do?
I don't know that I had that moment with any of them.
Okay. Or which was the one that made you most go, oh my gosh, I have no idea what to do?
Well, I will say, I guess somewhere through the contortion, to borrow what happened in Jonathan's play for a moment.
Nice.
I somehow, the pink fluffy pillow really kind of ironically enough grounded me when I, through this process, working with helpers, including Redmond Reams helped me
a lot.
I did John Servilio, just shout out to some Northwest Theater Workshop alums. There was something about using the pillow for the lion to express feelings. And once I kind of caught onto that idea, I was really having fun with that and imagining cats I've owned and what they do with physicality. Exactly. Wow.
Great, it was awesome. Okay, Justine, what was your prompt and what moved you the most? What inspired you?
Okay, my prompt was a vampire on a blind Zoom date with a box of cereal was torn between chaos and order.
Oh, God, Justine, you're so amazing.
And I thought cereal and I thought Count Chocula. What a natural fit.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what moved me. And then it naturally led into two vampire jokes or puns, not jokes. That's it.
Mm-hmm. All right, good. So again, you're a first time writer, or you know, a new writer. So does this whole thing make it easier for you to dive in, or does it just confuse you all the more?
No, I mean, having the prompt was, you know, those are kind of random things, but actually having the processes, the other writers and the other people associated with Northwest Theater know, really made it a lot easier than if you had told me about this 2 years ago, I would have been like, no, hard pass. No, thank you. I'm good. But yeah, having that like distinct process and the 7-step process made it a lot easier to do for sure.
That's great. That's great. And the results were wonderful. Kate, tell us about your prompt and what you came up with.
Oh, I was given the light heart comedy romp prompt of a lumberjack with a feather duster on a Zoom breakup, was torn between nurturing and taking control. So that's why it was so lighthearted, my piece. It was so lighthearted. Just a romp.
Yes, and it all came crashing down and crushed the poor guy. Yeah. So people are asking, was that owl? Was he eating owls?
No, I love that. Because he is that kind of guy. I wouldn't put it past him for a second. And then to not realize that he was eating the body of the owl that she is like screaming at him about. But no, the owl was decimated. Just completely destroyed. Left nothing but feathers. John, the actor who was playing Mac, went and got himself a steak, because if he's going to eat something on a fancy date night, it's going to be steak and bourbon, and that's definitely the Mac I wrote. That was so lovely to have them invent that. Yeah.
Great. And Jonathan, what was your prompt?
Mine was a protester with a hula hoop torn between justice and abuse of power. In a yoga session, that's where it was.
A Zoom yoga session.
And prior to like setting this all up, you know, we had a meeting, a company meeting of just ideas to shoot out. And I've been doing yoga one-on-one with my private instructor. And I was like, Zoom yoga session. Because I did not know what we were going to be using with these. CG was just like, I just need some ideas for...
What are things that can happen on Zoom that are a little silly?
And I was like... This is never going to come back to me.
Karma.
So my own karma back. But yeah, the prompt was, I guess I think the themes to me were the ones that were really good to think about. Cause I love this idea of like justice, and my definition of what justice is different than what other people's definition is. If you watched the last show that we were watching about, or the...
Oh my gosh, you kill so many people, Jonathan.
Kill people. Yeah, why are you so mean?
Jonathan Hernandez scripts, there's bodies everywhere.
Yeah, I just, I don't know. I see justice differently in the streets. But
Yeah, well, speaking of the streets, I was driving through Multnomah Village today, and there was a woman standing on the corner in yoga leotards holding three hula hoops. And I really wished I thought of you right away when I saw that.
Yeah. It's fun fact. I had to actually do a lot of research. I don't know if, I think Justine did too. We were just talking in the chat about like kind of getting an idea of the world that we're creating. And there's a lawsuit being displayed out or working through with the weighted hula hoops, and it's hurting people, causing some internal bleeding or bruising and stuff like that. And
like organ damage, right?
All right, there we go.
Ugh.
That's the launch.
Yeah, okay, I've got one last question. And audience too, this is open to you. Again, this whole thing is based on this kind of crazy exercise, this Mad Lib of a person, a prop, a place, and people struggling with the theme, which is just kind of a great exercise to help us think more deeply and connectively with the plays that we write. So audience, Did you notice any deeper connections on something that, you know, just frankly got whipped out in 2 days? Send us a thought. Let us know what your thoughts are. I'll read them out here. And then likewise, back to you writers, keeping yourself to these parameters, to this discipline. How is that different from what the way you usually work? And how's it bringing up good things for you? Just go ahead and raise your hand and let me know if you want to get something to say there. I won't call on somebody.
Okay, good.
Eight. I actually could use that question again, Wayne, sorry.
Yeah, so when you're given this restricting parameter of write about a person with a prop in a place who's struggling between this and that, I'm guessing that's not how you've written plays for 15, 20 years. So now that you've tried to make yourself do it within that, how has that been a benefit to you as a writer?
I super appreciate the push. And then it's lovely actually how much of my own like style it reveals, because even with these like things I would not pick, not likely to write about a Zoom breakup anytime soon. The way I still show up, like the way that my approach, the things I want to talk about are still going to be there. I have talked about how upset I was that this turned out to be such like a heavy play, and I want to rewrite it as Brad Balchunas and make it a comedy someday. Just because the man can't not make me laugh, and I'm curious to see what would happen. Like, I kind of like 6 months from now when we're all recovered, I kind of want to like swap prompts and see who does what differently. Just because even like given the same four things, I'm not going to write the same thing as Brad. And having this construct, this push, just makes so clear what is actually important in to me in my writing. Like, what's going to come up, what's going to bubble over. And it was amazing how much I saw, you know, my dear friends struggling with whether or not to have kids, my niece who works seasonal work all over the country, and my own, like, during a pandemic, having a partner and just having that partner over Zoom, like those things that like just showed up organically. And I didn't mean to talk about, but they're very much there. So I adore the construct. It's frustrating, of course, but you just lean in and you have so much fun. And then a feather duster is made out of the carcass of an owl and you're kind of gross, but it's okay.
Yeah, Judy Strelson from our audience loves the idea of switching prompts. So let's just do that. So why don't you guys by Sunday night? So we'll just kind of
get a little No, I get 6 months out. That was way not part of the subject.
Okay. All right. Anybody else care to comment on the discipline, the benefits of the discipline of writing to those parameters?
Yeah, I a lot of what Kate said I resonate with, and I really enjoy the even though they're prompts that I wouldn't pick. There's definitely a way that I, since working with Northwest Theater Workshop, is like, those are the kind of the go-to things that I need to make sure that I answer for my own work. So we have a seven-step process that we're just kind of fleshing out here and putting it into practice for this showcase. And we've always been working on it, but I think this around this time, it really, honed in some things that I some challenges that I always come up against, but also it just made me the things that I'm really good at is like accelerate the process. So even though the prompts are restrictive, it's something that's the setup is essential for me to building my plays. And I really resonate with Kate, with what you said about style and who you are, because I think it's like, it's still going to be my lens and how I view the world. Murder is, I guess, on my mind or whatever.
But it's still like
your signature is going to be in this and you're what you stand for and your perspective, no matter what the prompts are.
Good, good. Audience member Maren Curtis just asked, she had a great question there. Did you all brainstorm a bunch of ideas within your parameters and then pick one to write? Or did you just work with the first thing that came to your mind? Justine said a little bit of both. Justine, you wanna expand on that?
yeah, I guess a little bit. It was a little bit of brainstorming, but I mean, there's only so much you can do with vampires on a blind date. So I'd say, yeah, just starting with the process, right? And I don't want to give away the process, but you know, working on the event and then the AAs and the motifs. For me, that's like tying into the earlier piece, having that restrictive kind of framework really helped. And so it allows me to bring that like restricted framework, if that makes any sense. Mm-hmm. Maybe to only to the people who's written this past week.
Mm-hmm. Yep, great. Brad, last call. Got anything you want to add?
Just concur. It's strange. I'm known somewhat for in our group for the ideas and the hopscotching that I do, and I struggle mightily to stay in my lane, as it were, and kind of try to be decisive in that. And even with constraints, I start doing this hopping around business. Even though sometimes I curse them while I'm trying to write, like in this project on late Saturday night, mostly, I think, was where the cursing kind of amplified for me, you know, the pacing alone and whatnot, cursing to the universe. But then when they when you can kind of harness that, it's a really exciting feeling and hit on some things. And yeah, I agree with what the others were saying too. It's so great, the different voices coming out, moments of drama and comedy, I think, in each piece. And that's exciting and fulfilling.
Yeah. Okay, well, the results were wonderful. We all had a great time tonight. The brainstorming. Congratulations to you for it. Jonathan, were you good? We're trying to.
Yeah. Just real quick, the brainstorming question, I think is really good because I think you do start off with a bunch of ideas and then you play them through like in your mm-hmm. mind and you try to work the logic through to see how far is it going to go. And I think if it checks the boxes, kind of like the Kate play, if it checks the boxes, then you're kind of like, okay, I think I'm going to go this route.
You gotta join in though, Jonathan. You gotta join in.
Yeah.
For the brainstorming part, we were highly suggested to get a buddy. Like Brad mentioned, his Redmond Reams is another playwright in the company. But after I got my prompt, went immediately to my friend's house with a bottle of wine, and we talked about like the meaning of these themes and how they could be put at odds and all of this stuff. So it was a lot of brainstorming, but it was like removing clay from a sculpture. Like it was like chipping away to get to the right thing. There was a lot of brainstorming, but it was always just to get to the one, like it was in there. Like Jonathan was talking about, you like play it out and you're like, that's gonna die in like four pages. I can't maintain that. Or that doesn't build, like how does the feather duster being a gift from a mom help talk about nurturing very very much that. But I wanted to say thank you to Jay Minton for being my buddy that night, because that wine was not going to drink itself.
Nor the plays write themselves. So all right, wrapping up now. Folks in the chat, there was one member accidentally sent out a Zoom invite to something else. Just ignore that. All right, you're not invited. And you don't want to go. It's going to be boring, whatever it is, I'm sure. Not nearly as exciting as this. We have two more shows, one tomorrow, 2:00. And then on Sunday, 4:00, tell all your friends. All right, tell your friends all over the world. They don't have to be, you know, we're in Portland, but they can be anywhere.
Anywhere.
Yeah, so bring them, send them along, come along and join us again. Yeah, and come back yourselves if you like it again. We won't be swapping roles. We won't be swapping prompts by tomorrow. You never know. Also, again, we've got Northwest Theater Workshop Showcase coming up May 15th, which may include some of these writers you see here on screen. Yes, yes.
I think.
With all new works, where they've actually got to think about them for a little while. So who knows what depths they'll plumb. Mm-hmm. All right, that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And this is Northwest Theater Workshop and Comedy Sports Portland saying thank you. And good night.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks for coming.
Thanks.